So we're going to get started. If everybody take their seats. Thank you. So welcome to the Code Fireside panel for 2016. It's really going to be a great topic and obviously a tremendous set of panelists, which I'm very excited to speak to today. So again, in the theme of the conference, we want to engage in a dialogue. So I want to kick it off by starting with some questions to sort of lay it out, but I really want you guys to get involved. There are mics. Raise your hand if you're holding a mic that's going to be distributed. So there's two roaming mics here, strategically placed right next to each other. And so, you know, just raise your hand if you want to ask a question and the mic will come to you, and then we'll go in order of the people who get the mic in their hand. So, you know, today we want to talk and have a dialogue about the proliferation of algorithms in our society and what the potential ramifications of that proliferation are for a number of things, you know, of interest, our welfare, our outcomes, and so on. And, you know, as we're all aware, I think, at this point, algorithms are everywhere. They are suggesting what we read. They're suggesting what types of things we look at on the internet. They're suggesting who we date, who we're friends with, our jobs, our employment, our healthcare, our insurance coverage, our financial outcomes, like our interest rates, as we talked about, and so on. But recent research has also shown that algorithms may bias outcomes towards discrimination and reify inequality. So I'll give you some examples. For instance, in criminal justice, there's a program called COMPASS, Correctional Officer Management Profiling for Alternative Sanctions, where judges, police, and parole officers use machine learning to determine the risk or predict the risk of recidivism, and specifically violent recidivism, among inmates. But black defendants are nearly twice as likely to be misclassified as high risk than white defendants beyond the baseline of their actual observed risk of recidivism after the fact. In search advertising, for instance, search ads that are associated with black and white baby name searches, ads containing the word, quote, arrest were shown next to 80% of black names, black name searches in one study, but less than 30% for white name searches. That's a study by LaTanya Sweeney at Harvard and colleagues. And everybody's probably aware of the last spring Microsoft unleashed the chatbot Tay upon us. Thank you for that, Ronnie. We really appreciate that.
I'm sure it did not go through his A-B testing platform.
Exactly. Which is part of what we want to talk about today. And, you know, Tay just quickly began, you know, using racist language and neo-Nazi views on Twitter, which was, you know, an interesting outcome. So we've assembled a distinguished panel to help us talk about this and think about this. And I want you to notice that the panel is not the same panel that's advertised on the website. And the reason for that is, in the spirit of randomization, we thought we would randomly substitute some panelists for other panelists to see what would happen. We're really pleased to have these folks with us. So I do want to introduce these folks sort of in the anti-spirit of code, because we have some people who are not part of the conference who are coming from outside, and we're also going to share this you know, video publicly as well. So I'm going to introduce them in order. David Parks, sitting next to me, is a Harvard College professor, George F. Colony Professor of Computer Science, area dean for computer science at Harvard University, where he leads research at the interface between economics and computer science. He's got a focus on e-commerce, artificial intelligence, machine learning, AAAI fellow, served as the chair of the ACM Special Interest Group on e-commerce, and is editor of several journals, and as I will say with every single panelist, has won numerous awards for his research, none of which I'm going to list here. Sitting next to him is Alessandro Acquisti. Many of you know him. He's a professor of IT and public policy at the Heinz College at CMU. He's co-director of the CMU Center for Behavioral and Decision Research. He investigates the economics of privacy, and he's really sort of at the forefront of applying behavioral economics to the analysis of privacy, information security, decision making, and the analysis of privacy disclosure in social networks and elsewhere. He's also won numerous awards. He's testified before both houses of Congress on issues related to privacy policy, consumer behavior, and he's served on the National Academy's Committee on Public Responses to Alerts and Warnings in Social Media. Really, really pleased to have you here, Alessandro. Sitting next to him, many of you know Catherine Tucker, Sloan Distinguished Professor of Management and Professor of Marketing at MIT, Chair of the PhD program at MIT, Sloan School. Her research focuses on online advertising, digital health, social media, electronic privacy, and it really lies at the interface of marketing, economics, and law. She's also received many, many, many awards. Co-editor of the Quantitative Marketing and Economics Journal and a research associate at the MBER. Sitting next to her, Sandy Pentland, who's received no awards, unfortunately. He directs MIT's Human Dynamics Laboratory and the MIT Media Lab Entrepreneurship Program. He co-leads the World Economic Forum Big Data and Personal Data Initiatives. He's a founding member of the advisory boards of Nissan, Motorola Mobility, Telefonica, and lots of startups. 2012, Forbes named him one of the 7 most powerful data scientists in the world. He's one of the most cited computer scientists in the world, and he has pioneered all sorts of things, going all the way back to eigenfaces, which is some of the most foundational work, I think, in computer vision. I mean, you have to go way back, and that stuff is cited like, you know, tens of thousands of times. So thank you very much, Sandy, for being here. And of course, everyone knows Susan Athey, economics of technology professor at Stanford Graduate School of Business, previously also taught at much less well-known schools like MIT, Stanford, Harvard. 2007, she won the John Bates Clark Medal, which lots of people win from the AEA. And the AEA gives that to, quote, the American economist under 40 who is adjudged to have made the most significant contribution to economic thought and knowledge. That's kind of, you know, so-so. elected to the National Academy of Science in 2012, Academy of Arts and Sciences in 2018. She is the most broad and deep person I've ever met. I mean, how can you be so broad and deep and still, like, have kids and have a life? You're awesome. Thank you for being here. We really appreciate it. And thank you to everyone else for being here. There are equally qualified people in the audience, so I really would appreciate you piping up. So the person who couldn't be here today is a woman named Zeynep Tufekci, who was also amazing. And there was just a mix-up in coordination. She's really, really sorry she couldn't be here. She's very disappointed, just an amazing person. She's a former computer scientist who's now a sociologist at UNC. She's got a very popular New York Times column that writes about all sorts of things. And I wanted to start with a quote that she has in one of these op-eds and to give a question to David to sort of start us off. So she wrote in the New York Times, quote, "With algorithms, we don't have an engineering breakthrough that's making life more precise, but billions of semi-savant mini Frankensteins. Algorithms are often presented as an extension of natural sciences like physics or biology. While these algorithms use data, math, and computation, they're a fountain of biases and slants of a new kind." And so my question to kick it off with David is, what kind of biases and slants do we really need to be worried about with algorithmic thinking sort of promulgating? And is there a large swath of decisions we should be worried about algorithms biasing? And can you give us some examples?
Sure. So first of all, very happy to be here. Look, I'm a computer scientist. I believe in algorithms. I believe in AI. I believe in using data, but I do think that we have to be very careful here. I think that with the power we have comes a lot of responsibility. And one thing I was thinking about is, imagine that I'm writing an algorithm to decide how to place ads to recruit an expert in experimental design. And let's say I collect the most natural data set, which is I go to the people at this conference, and I collect all of the attributes about you, and I score you all as a 1, and then I go and find some other people, then I score them as a 0, and then I go ahead and I say, okay, this is how I'm gonna, how I will target my my job ads. Now, presumably my algorithm is gonna chase men. There are, thankfully, quite a few women in the room, but there are more men than women here. There are probably more white men than non-white men here, although I'm not quite sure. But of course, the point is that that may be a good predictive algorithm, but it quite likely is not the right algorithm to find the best person. So now, if you can hold that in mind, and if you can think about that example that I just gave you, which hopefully makes things quite real, now think about the things that we're looking to do with algorithms. So we're looking to use algorithms for predictive policing in cities. We're looking to use data that may well reflect existing policies for how we police in cities to make decisions about how to police and where to send resources into the future. And of course, the worry there is quite natural, which is that we reinforce the biases that already exist in the data. I think many would agree that that there are human factors, there are biases that are coming into how resources are being deployed in society at the moment. And we don't want to reinforce those into the future. So I think the job targeting, the predictive policing, where within criminal justice, it's widely known that that data is poor, therefore we must be careful. One other example I'll give you is examples where algorithms can fail in a very non-human way. So vision algorithms, we've seen the embarrassments that have happened with search engines incorrectly labeling dark-skinned people as a gorilla. We've seen examples of camera technology firms incorrectly labeling Asian faces as blinking, and therefore you should take another photograph. We've seen examples of other technologies not correctly identifying faces. So these are errors of a different kind. These are not errors that are perpetuating biases that exist in data sets. I think of these as errors that are very non-human and that we wouldn't expect any of us to make, but that algorithms that are not correctly validated might make and are making.
Awesome, thank you. So that begs the question a little bit. So Alessandro, you've done work, experiments that look not at algorithmic biases, but for instance, how human beings might have biases in their reactions to information. So are we better off just turning this over to human decision makers? Is that the right strategy? The algorithms are biased, so let the humans take over and make all of these decisions?
So indeed, my work is not about algorithms per se, it's about human decision making and economic implications of that decision making. I believe that the experiment you may be referring to was the hiring experiment.
Exactly.
It's an experiment we ran a couple of years ago with Christina Fong at Carnegie Mellon. It was an attempt at seeing whether employers in the US are already using social media to find information about prospective job candidates, and whether they find on social media personal information which they could not ask during an interview, and whether this information ends up affecting their behaviors in terms of who they call for interviews. And so we created LinkedIn and Facebook profiles. We manipulated information in the Facebook profiles, which is generally not asking interviews. In fact, in many jurisdictions may be illegal to ask about, such as sex orientation or religious affiliation. And then we sent out CVs to about 4,000 or over 4,000 openings in the US. Of course, with no link whatsoever to the LinkedIn or Facebook profiles. If the employers who received these resumes decided on their own volition to search online for the names of the people in the resumes, they would find our profile. So it was kind of like the Bertrand and Mullenhuyten design from 2004 updated to the Web 2.0 world. And what we captured were callback rates, and we did find that there were differences in callback rates, which had to be due to employers finding Facebook profiles and finding personal information by the candidates, because otherwise the candidates were, in terms of educational attainments and professional achievements, exactly identical. Mm-hmm. Indeed, the Muslim candidate was much less likely to be called for interviews than the Christian candidate, especially in the most conservative states in the US. So, from our perspective, we didn't know whether these decisions were being made by humans or algorithms, because the decision-making internal to the firm was a black box. Mm-hmm. However, the connection to your question is that wearing my economist hat on, as you provide more information in a market, such as the job market, you provide more information through new channels, such as internet, search engines, social media. You can have two different effects, and these two effects could actually exist in parallel. You improve matching, because employers can find more relevant information about employees, and employees can find better information about firms that they want to work for. But simultaneously, you can also provide information which should not be used in the hiring process. And interestingly for us, the information we manipulated in the experiment was indeed information which was protected. In a way, the experiment is about showing what happens when the legislator decided that certain information should not be used in the hiring process because it's not in the best interest of collectivity. But in fact, now we have technologies which are effectively bypassing the legislation because no one is forcing us to publish personal information online, but we do it, and we do it openly, which means that we do it and we reveal it to strangers, but also to strangers, to friends, strangers as well, to the algorithms. And how the algorithms will end up using this information, it's still up to be seen.
Yeah, so this is to building off something David said. So I want to sort of distinguish between the algorithm and the data, or the training data, okay? So a good question to ask, I think, in this process is it a problem with the algorithm, or is it a problem with bias training data that reifies an inequality or a bias that exists? Now, that could come from you sampled the data incorrectly, okay? Or it could come from that inequality actually exists in society and the algorithm reifies it. Or it could be the machine itself. So the machine learning algorithm, the way it's coded, you know, by the majority white men who occupy positions of coding algorithms, is that the problem? So I want to make this a little bit more concrete with Catherine. So you guys all remember the beauty AI beauty contest just happened, I think it was this year. So this company called Beauty AI created a beauty contest where they algorithmically chose the most beautiful sort of people among 6,000 selfies that were provided from 100 different countries, okay? So they trained a machine learning algorithm and then they selected the most beautiful people. The vast majority of the 44 winners were white. In fact, that there was only one dark-skinned winner out of 44 and only a handful of Asian winners, and the rest were white men and women.
What's the training set?
So the chief scientist of Beauty AI said that the problem was that they didn't have enough minority examples in the training set, okay? So Catherine, I know I've seen this recent working paper that you have that looks at discrimination in algorithmic advertising for STEM education, gender discrimination. And I got the sense there that it wasn't necessarily a problem with the training set, but potentially a problem with the machine itself, the coding. And I want you to explain it a little bit. But my question is it the machine? Is it the data? Or is it some combination of both that sort of leads to this problem?
So I think it's a really nice point, because my intuition always is that the data story, where you have the wrong training data, that's something we can all understand, right? So that's what makes it such a good example. My worry about algorithms stems more for cases where things happen that a reasonably intelligent person couldn't have predicted. So I'm just going to illustrate this. I'll give you a quick summary of the paper that Sinan is talking about. So what we did in this paper was we ran a field test of an ad which encouraged people into STEM careers. And you know, there's a general belief that in women don't apply enough for STEM careers. And we ran this ad on a social media site and said it's gender neutral. Now, having said that, it was shown to 20% more men than women. And that's quite a large number, right, of misallocation. And then the interesting question is why that happened. So what's funny is that, no offense, men, when I tell men about this result, their general reaction is often, well, you know, maybe it's just that women didn't click on the ad, and the algorithm learned that women don't click on the ad, so they didn't show it. Some sort of like women self-inflict story. That's not what happened. If women were ever lucky enough to see the ad, they clicked on it more than men, right? So that's not the story. We also wondered whether it was because perhaps the machine had learned something about the bias of the country. And so we tested this ad at 190 different countries with lots of different degrees of bias. We still see this pattern. And what's interesting is this pattern was most pronounced in the richer countries where you might think that perhaps there's more gender equality. So when we came to what the real explanation was that it turned out that in the data, women's eyeballs are expensive. Men, I'm sorry to tell you this, you're just not as worth as much to advertisers, especially relative to the highly desirable group of women aged 25 to 45. And certainly, if you've ever been with women on Facebook, you can testify to the number of shoe ads you see, the number of baby ads, and so on. And what's happening is that these advertisers are bidding up women in a way which means they're crowding out ads that might have been intended to be gender neutral. So what to take from this? Well, ultimately, that is really hard to predict. If you just looked at the algorithm, it would look like a really nice, well-designed algorithm which is designed to make the distribution of advertising as cost-effective as possible, right? Who's going to quarrel with that? The problem is it can have unintended consequences. And so, you know, I'm sort of almost going beyond saying, you know, to the original question, is it a problem of the coders being sexist? No, I don't think they were being sexist. I think they were doing a really good job. I don't think it was the training data. That's definitely not the problem. We reeled that out. Instead, it's that sometimes algorithms can have unintended consequences. And that's, for me, the real worry. Mm-hmm.
So, Sandy, you know, you perhaps more than anyone are qualified to tell us a little bit about what are the different approaches around the world in your role at the World Economic Forum and so on. So can you sort of just give us a lay of the land of the different international approaches to this problem, what people are doing, and,
sure.
and whether you think we're on the right track?
So I think that we're at a really interesting point, and I would like to emphasize the positive. And I'll do it this way. So about 2 years ago, I was asked to be on a special committee for the UN Secretary General as they forged the new 15-year goals for the United Nations, the Sustainable Development Goals. And they had noticed that the goals that they set that they don't measure very well don't happen. Surprising. So this time they wanted to measure them. They wanted to measure, they have 17 goals that have to do with equality and poverty and sustainability and so forth. And what they'd like to do is provide essentially real time, or at least high frequency, objective measurements of all progress towards all these goals along multiple dimensions uniformly in every country in the world. And you might say, well, that's really nice. First of all, that's an incredible concept. The idea of being able to know what's going on in every country in the world and being able to talk about it. I mean, like, this is mind-boggling, right? You say, well, but it'll never happen. However, you need to also know that people like the World Bank and so forth are going to condition loans and cash flows based on the data. So there's a cash incentive for countries to be able to do it and do it in a fairly good way. Now, that got passed. Every country in the world except North Korea and I think that's about it, signed it. And all the national statistical offices who are supposed to do this freaked out because they have no idea how to do this. They've been doing surveys for 100 years, right? And now they're being told to use private data from telcos, from banks, from cars, from whatever, to be able to assess things that they've never thought about, like equality, like ethnic violence and so forth. And this is particularly salient in the EU, where we've just gotten these new data protection laws in there, which protect a much stronger protection for personal data than you have in this country. And they're wondering what to do. So we've been funded by, we've been doing experiments in this area for a couple years with some with the World Bank, with the World Economic Forum, with Orange, with various governments, particularly in Cote d'Ivoire, Senegal, and Italy, of all places, on how to use this big data to measure societal properties and how to do it safely. And what we do is we go in and collect all this data and try and anonymize it as best as we can and then give it out to hundreds of academic institutions to try and use it, break it, comment on it. And we've come up with a way of handling this data for public good. So the idea is, how do you make open data for public good out of private data without endangering everything you can imagine and without the sort of biases that you're talking about? And it's really very simple, at least the first step. It's called open algorithms. So the idea is you don't share data. You don't move data. What you do is you come up with a set of algorithms that have been publicly debated and looked at and approved, and only those are used for querying against these databases to produce answers which have been, by experts, looked at and said they don't contain personal data, they're not biased in various ways. And I like it for a couple reasons. One is, it's a simple thing to do. This idea of looking at this and having a public debate, what that does is it gets the public involved and it makes people much more aware about it. But the other thing that's really interesting to think about is law is like algorithms, right? And the execution of algorithms is like what bureaucracies do, or the police, or the judges, right? And what we are at is a point now where we can set up a new system for public creation and approval of algorithms and assessment of whether those things are doing the right job. Mm-hmm. So we're at a point where we could potentially change the social contract to involve people much more broadly than our existing political institutions. Mm-hmm. So that's the thing to think about.
Yeah, that's great.
Right? So that's the good side. Yeah. The bad side is we could screw it all up and kill everybody. So let's not do that, okay?
So in the interest of not doing that, Susan, I've heard a lot of suggestions out there in the world about how we should address this problem. What do you think in terms of, technical, legal, other types of solutions to addressing some of these issues?
Sure. So maybe I'll just start by questioning the whole premise. Actually, I think everybody's been a really good sport of going along with your premise of biased algorithms. But in fact, the vast majority of the research that I've seen so far shows that the algorithms do better than people. Mm-hmm. And so maybe I'll just start by a few of those examples. There's been a few papers already about hiring decisions where machines look at resumes and decide who to interview. And then the machines do better than the people. And part of the, when you try to dig into it, it's partly because when people are looking at resumes, they tend to be biased towards their own colleges or other types of things, the information that they have, and they kind of overweight their own information. Justin Rao has a paper out about stop and frisk in New York, and he finds that if you give an algorithm the kinds of observable information police could have, and you sort of condition on that, that in the predicted sort of chance of having a gun for stop and frisk for the purpose of weapons, the chance that an African American actually has a gun is like a third or a fourth of the chance that a white person has a gun. So the objective chance is much, much lower for a black person than a white person conditional on being stopped and frisked. And if you instead kind of, that the implication of that is if you instead gave sort of algorithmic guidelines to the police, that they could do a much more effective job of policing, find more weapons, stop less black people, and make everybody more cooperative and feel safer. When you look at Sindel Melanathan's work on these, looking at judicial pre-trial release decisions, that you can actually reduce jail populations by like a third, and be less discriminatory by using algorithms. Mm-hmm. So I think that it's often the case that humans make certain kinds of mistakes. You know, they think the judge is looking into your soul, but really they're kind of seeing indigestion from lunch. And in fact, other papers have shown that if it's a bad day for the judge, their favorite sport team lost, all sorts of other idiosyncratic things affect sentences. So sometimes actually discretion is bad. We've had decades of evidence about things like blind orchestra trials and sort of taking away information, actually improving decision making. I see it in my own life in academics. If you're on a committee and you say, oh, suggest who should win a prize, you get one answer. If you say, let's make a list of everybody and look at citations, even though the citations themselves are biased and everything else, you're still going to get, many more women on the list just by making an objective list, and which is kind of, making the process a little more algorithmic. Mm-hmm. So I think these things have actually incredible promise to help us with our own biases. And in some sense, I think it's much easier to solve the problem of adding some constraints to an algorithm, fixing problems with data sets and so on, than it is to unbias us. Because, of course, women are also biased. If you look at all the stuff in your Facebook feed about, I hope some of you have read all these interesting articles about how hard it is to be a woman in the workplace and so on in this election season, the evidence is that actually both women and men judge women badly when they're seeking power. And so on. Mm-hmm. So it's actually very hard to debias us, and making things a little more objective, I think, is a good thing. Even Catherine's example, though, I'd say sometimes if you were hand selling those ads, we were hand selling ads targeted to women, the price would be higher probably if you went and asked the MSN Salesforce. They charge more for those too. Mm-hmm. So it's I think it's more about the information and the objective. So I'm actually I'm really excited about the promise of algorithms to make things more objective. Now, my big kind of things to do about it, though, do about problems, I also am very worried that all of our cars are going to crash and our robots are going to go haywire if we're not careful. Because I lived in a search engine, which is like the ultimate algorithmic machine, for a long time. And I saw how much, these algorithms are awesome and they're deep, but they only do what you tell them to do. So you give them an objective, and they'll maximize that objective. And if you don't put a constraint on them, they'll go haywire. So if something crazy is predictive today, the algorithm will, if you hold it to optimize, it'll use that variable all the way to the extreme, even though it makes no sense and it might be very unstable. So if you don't tell the algorithm you want it to be stable, you want it to be robust, you want it to work in a changing environment, you're not going to get that. If you put up an A/B testing platform and you say, maximize for short-term revenue, and the engineers will develop things that maximize short-term revenue. That's what they'll do. And some of those things could be very, very destructive. Mm-hmm. And so, the role of the people, the economist, the social scientist, the business person, the human in the room is partly like to recognize, all right, we get what we measure, we get what we ask for in algorithms. And the thing is that, when you did it in the old world and you just said, I'm going to give you a bonus if you sell a lot, people would manipulate, but they were only so good at it. Mm-hmm. But machines, they'll drive you off the cliff so dang fast you won't even know what hit you. Mm-hmm. And they'll go haywire so fast. And the thing about the cars, you do A/B testing. You can imagine, I'm going to test a new algorithm in my controlled, racetrack behind the university. But then, you know, all the cars are getting an input, and they're gonna expect other cars to respond in a certain way. You can easily imagine these edge cases where, like, you know, you change something that works fine for the cars in isolation, but then if all the cars do it, you know, they crash into each other. And we had the, I mean, Ronnie's written very eloquently about examples like this in online experimentation. You test something on 5%, it's great. You release it to the whole system, and then it crashes, and you have to, like, turn things off and restart it. You know, and we that, this happens with billions of dollars at stake, so I don't see why it's like not going to happen with these much more complex machines in the future. So, you know, I think the thing I would say that's common across the discrimination, but actually just across like basic safety, is going to be that we really have to think about unintended consequences. What are the constraints? We don't just want algorithms that do the best they can in a very narrow sense. We're going to actually have to think very hard as humans about the objective functions. And the last thing I'll throw out on that, though, is that sometimes that's going to make us very, very uncomfortable. Mm-hmm. So you probably all got in your Facebook feed the thing about, like, who do you kill, the kid or the you know, you kill yourself, the driver, the kid on the street, or five kids in the sidewalk. You know, we actually are going to have to take a stand on that, mm-hmm. and that's going to make us uncomfortable. Economists have always been fine with this. We write health economics papers. We're like, life, it's $1 million, you know. So, yeah, you shouldn't invest in this because it's not going to save enough lives. You know, people think we're awful and cruel and mean and terrible to write those things in our papers, but now everybody's going to have to do that.
So I want to build off of what Susan just said and what Sandy said with Catherine and Alessandro, and I'll start with what Sandy said. He talked about the transparency of having people be able to vet the algorithms and only adopt when they're transparent. He also mentioned the tougher EU privacy laws, okay? So, Catherine, you probably know, given your involvement in sort of the legal aspect of privacy, the new sort of European Commission privacy protection laws, and specifically this concept of a right to an explanation around algorithms. So for those of you who don't know, the updated guidance on the EU privacy laws, not the actual law, but the guidance that goes along with the law says that every citizen has a right to an explanation about why an algorithm chose what it did about their outcome. Okay? So my question is, transparency. Is this a solution? Is it enough of a solution? Is it even feasible to explain to every single person why they didn't see a STEM ad on Facebook? In a deep algorithmic sort of way.
Okay, oh, it's a wonderful question. Okay, so I should just explain for those of you who are not sort of au fait with this. Algorithmic transparency has been a little bit of a cooling slogan. I know this because my husband's a privacy activist and his laptop's covered with stickers saying, algorithmic transparency. Now, I'm going to, disappoint my husband here and say, I don't know, I'm not convinced it is a solution. And the reason first of all, I mean, Sinan said it very well, right? You know, is the EU policy plausible? No. It is a wonderful illustration of EU policy written by people who, some of you are laughing now, you know what I'm saying, right? It's for people who perhaps are a little bit removed from the technology itself. You know, just imagine having to put an algorithm up there and explaining it. It's just quite it's an interesting idea. Having said that, I think my worry about algorithmic transparency as a slogan is it's been so embraced because it's so sexy and it sort of sounds like a solution that it means that we're missing, in some sense, my major concerns about algorithms, right? And this goes back to Susan's point, which is the human in the room, right? Because if we just think the solution to thinking about algorithms and what the extreme edge cases may be that we're worried about is, then just posting the algorithm up there and letting us inspect it or understand it isn't going to help us. Instead, what we should be doing is thinking how to encourage thoughtfulness about all the things that those initial programmers didn't think about in terms of unintended consequences. So I worry it's going to be one of those policies which just sounds like very nice and everyone's like, let's do it and ban it. It's like, great, we can just do it. But it's going to distract us really from what our major job is.
Mm-hmm. So building on that and what Susan said, it seems to me that we need to go a little bit further. And one concept, potentially, given how many experiments you've done, is this notion of combining experimentation and machine learning, right? Mm-hmm. So we know that we can use machine learning to help us design experiments. We can use experiments to help us design algorithms. And we can use machine learning to help us interpret and do inference on experimental data. How can experiments help us potentially see the flaws in algorithms, provide experimentation in the loop that that solves this problem, and get over the problem that Ronnie has so eloquently written about around small-scale experiments when released in the wild sort of fall apart or break us?
They can, but starting from connecting two points Susan and Catherine made that I very much agree with. Algorithms could help avoiding the biases which arise from human decision making, but in order to know whether that is happening, transparency solutions, I agree with Catherine, are not enough. And to me, experimentation can help, but may end up suffering from the same problem of transparency. That I see transparency and experimentation using terms from logic and mathematics as necessary but not sufficient tools. There have been good experiments, for instance, Anupam Data, CNU, on trying to understand what happens in the black box from the perspective of an outsider in academia of online advertising, and trying to design experiments to detect discrimination in advertising. The problem with these tools, as well designed as they are multiple. One is that from as long as you work from the outside, so as long as you are not inside the entity or the organization which develop and train the algorithm, even the most the best design experiment may actually eventually be vitiated by some confound, which will undermine the causal link that you try to establish in your study. A second, some of these studies are really, really, really costly to run. The hiring experiment I was referring to earlier took some months to run, but actually some years to design, a little army of research assistants, lots and lots of effort, and the problem with this is that I don't see how it could ever be replicated, how another scientist would be willing to put the same amount of money and time into just replicating a result, because your replication in academia is not particularly valued and doesn't lead you to top publications or tenure. So again, from the perspective of outsiders, we can run these costly and challenging experiments, but then we don't know how reliable and robust they are. And the third problem is that some of these experiments are actually risky to run from the outside. And by risky, I'm referring to the CFAA, which is a federal act. I think CFAA stands for Computer Fraud and Abuse Act. It was enacted in the 80s under the Reagan administration, initially as a anti-hacking act. But over the years, it started morphing. I could even use the term, it became a Frankenstein, because it started being used for more and more purposes, including, more recently, to go after activists or potentially even researchers who are seen as violating a site or a site terms of services. So that violations of terms of services, TOS or a website, which normally would be bad, but just a TOS violation, could actually become a federal felony. And by the way, here in Cambridge, I believe many of us are aware of the story of Aaron Swartz. And this, to me, tells that experiments can do something, but done from the outside, they cannot tell everything. Which brings up the issue of would organizations be willing to do the experiments from the inside to regularly validate and test what their own algorithms end up predicting, how they end up acting. And here I will use my Latin and I will say quiz custodes, ipsos custodes. So who is going to monitor those who are supposed to monitor?
The monitors, yeah. Sandy, you had your hand up. Is that still a hand, or?
Yeah, I mean, so I wanted to talk about transparency and stuff, and I absolutely agree that just posting algorithms isn't going to do anything. To me, the core thing comes down to, from a legal language, it's called informed consent. Mm-hmm. So it's not just experts. We have to have everyone, or the average person, understand what's happening. And what that means is they have to become educated about it in some way, which means probably what we do with algorithms needs to be standardized
Do you see any competitive problem with that? That all these companies just open up the kimono and give away the crown jewels of all their optimization?
Well, obviously there's some problems there, but it's a question of, does everything have to be that way? Mm-hmm. It's just like law, right? Not everything is done in public law. Some things are done by local rules, some things are done privately, right? So the thing we're doing, okay, is we're building tools that allow you to understand complicated algorithms, to be able to take the decisions that are made and project them on human understandable variables so that it's not 100% what the algorithm is doing, but you can say 10% of the variance is due to gender. With the human doing it, it was only 2%. Is that good? Mm-hmm. Let's talk about that. What are the implications of that? I don't think we're going to get it right. Mm-hmm. I think what we need to do is we need to have ways of understanding it that are accessible to large numbers of people. So we need to build those tools, and we need to have this sort of data literacy that happens. Just like we need to have literacy about how government works, literacy about how various other sorts of law works. Mm-hmm. Like, for instance, one of the things that as an American, I always assumed that informed consent was something that was a common idea worldwide, because I would get little loan forms to say, if you borrow this money, you pay this much, and here's your, you know, your record and your FICO score, and this means that you have this interest rate and stuff. And I talked to, for instance, one of my Italian students, and he said, no, you go talk to your friend's uncle who sits behind the desk, and if you pissed him off, he's not going to give you a loan. Right? If he's your buddy, you're in good. And so this notion of how things are done and the idea that there should be a lawful, regular way that everybody has understands and sort of had some input into is the thing that we have to achieve. Mm-hmm. This is obviously really hard, but I don't see that anything less is going to actually make do. Mm-hmm.
David?
Yeah, so I think we need to get back to worrying about the data. Mm-hmm. So for me, the data is much more of a concern than the algorithm. I think that we're making great strides in how to write, for example, AI systems that are able, when presented with the right data, able to learn how to act. The thing I really worry about is that in computer science, in AI, in our field, we are way too naive about the difference between predictive models and causal models. And I feel like I'm preaching to the crowd here, but you all think about, I think a lot of people here think about advertising and marketing. So now think about that we're on the cusp of having algorithmic systems that are going to be making physical decisions that will affect our the way we move around our cities, affect how our cities function, how policing functions. And these are, you know, no offense to marketing, I like marketing questions, but these are very, very tangible things that will really affect society. Mm-hmm. And I'm quite afraid that unless we do a much better job of communicating out to computer science and AI that if you make decisions based on predictive models for observational data, you are going to quite likely do the wrong thing in the world. And mm-hmm. this is just so underappreciated. Mm-hmm. If I could just say one other thing, mm-hmm. This idea of having a requirement that an algorithm be transparent is so bizarre. This idea that what does that even mean to explain why my algorithm did something? It's mm-hmm. like people have no idea what an algorithm is. Mm-hmm. When do I start? Do I start when I start training the algorithm a decade ago? And then do I have to explain that whole decade of process? I just don't even know how to begin interpreting that. So it's one thing to say that it would be nice to have interpretable models. Mm-hmm. But it's another thing to say that the decision of an algorithm should be transparent. I cannot begin to understand what that means. And the effect that that will have on innovation, if Europe is going to take that seriously. I'm not a fan of the Brexit decision, but thank goodness for Brexit, is what I say.
So I'm going to ask one more question of Susan, then I'm going to open it up. So be ready with your questions. I know Eric has one in the back. And so if the people with the microphones can, Eric has one, and then there's others as well. So Susan, you alluded to this when you said, look, we're going to have to make some tough choices. Do we go with the one kid in the street or the five kids on the sidewalk type of thing? These are not easy problems to solve. So like structural racism is not something that you can solve by tweaking your algorithm. Am I wrong or am I right? And the question is this something that we can expect to solve by, you know, addressing the algorithmic piece of it? Or is this really just a panacea for the much more difficult societal problem or problems themselves?
Well, maybe on an optimistic side, all over the world, we have huge problems of just the rule of law, personal safety. You know, I went to give a talk at a conference in Copacabana, and like, basically, you know, they're like, no, you can't even wear your watch when you walk to the beach because the local police are all in cahoots with the people who are out there mugging you on the beach, and you're thinking, you know, like, how can you not? Like, and there's this really expensive hotel there, and you're like, how can you not be able to find a solution to this? And so, you know, actually being able to monitor and record and evaluate, you know, on a large scale by something objective can really solve just huge numbers of problems. There was another study of absenteeism in medical clinics in Pakistan, and it turned out that like half the doctors just weren't going to work. You know, and so there was no doctor at the clinic when they were audited. And so then, but if you start monitoring whether they actually show up, you know, you can actually get doctors to come to work and treat people. And if you think about inspectors, like going to inspect buildings, which then like, you know, in Italy, all these buildings collapse in the earthquake and, you know, the inspector never went to the building. You know, so if you could start to kind of automate a lot of these things and just have, you know, auditing and verification, you can just make the world like just a much, much safer place and also a fairer place. Now the nexus of abuse can change. So like one centralized person can spy on all of you, you know, and so from a surveillance perspective, it's like just terrifying. From a government effectiveness perspective, if you can actually make the thing fair, then it can be fair at scale. Mm-hmm. So, I think this is the role of our institutions and actually like monitoring the government and having an effective government, I think will really, really change. But I do think we could actually, like just having the body cameras on the police, you know, and then just even like if we could have machines like review that data, we wouldn't just need, just find out about problems when somebody gets shot, but we might find out about just ongoing systematic problems that actually led to the police mistrust to start with. So I'm actually very, very optimistic about this. If we have a benevolent government.
I didn't know you were going to bring the election into
that. Yeah, so, I mean, of course, you know, to do that, we need, we need newspapers, and we need democracy, and we need to educate people,
Great
and we
point.
Need people to vote in their interests and all sorts of other things, which, of course, you know, we can come into question. But I think that you know, generally, the hard part, though, is actually specifying what it is you want. You know, what is it that we actually want these algorithms to do? And I think, you know, in businesses already, people just have a very hard time. Think about robo-advising. You know, what do you want your robo-advisor to do? well, if I put that into a standard setup, you know, there's going to be an algorithm to tell people what to do. There's going to be algorithms that show what should be on the screen. And then I'm going to try to look at user satisfaction metrics. You know, I can just, my robo-advisor is probably going to make you happier if it shows the graphs of, like, your portfolio going up, up, up. And, you know, it's probably going to make you less satisfied if it shows you, you know, the scenarios where, like, you run out of money. And, you know, they're going to probably be resilient to that extreme thing, but there's going to be much more subtle ways. We know from optimizing a search engine, like, I can lay out information a little bit differently, and you're going to pay different attention to it. And if I just maximize, you know, 1 month or even 1 year user satisfaction, the screen I give you is not going to give you the right financial advice. To think that through and to think about how to fix it, even if you're benevolent as a firm, is quite hard. If you're a manager who thinks you're going to leave in 3 years, it's another question entirely. And so even just in these kind of easier cases where the business objectives are clear, nobody's doing this well right now. And we're certainly going to have a harder time doing it as we go into harder and harder problems where the machines go.
Awesome.
So I think that's going to be even harder when we go to societal problems.
Thank you. So opening it up, first Eric, and then there's a hand over here. Hand over here, and so on.
So first off, I want to compliment this panel. I was watching the live stream yesterday of the White House Frontiers Conference. They had a very similar panel, very similar topic, much lower level discussion. So in particular, there weren't a lot of people who really understood algorithms on it, and there was this overwhelming, I think, presumption or assumption that the algorithms were biased, and this was a huge problem, and this was a real, you know, getting worse and worse. And I mean, maybe I'm betraying my own biases here because you're kind of more my sort of people. I found your discussion much more convincing. I want to pick up on what a lot of you said, but especially what Susan said at the end, and even push a little further, challenging the premise a bit that maybe these algorithms could be doing a lot to unbias what's happening. But then ultimately, the issue is, do we even know what bias is, and what is it? To some extent, what Susan was saying in their second remarks about what our goals are. I mean, so we can, there are some things we say, okay, that's obviously discriminatory, but where do you start deciding what our values are? Do you want to consider age? You know, if there's some religion that is underrepresented, what if there's some religion that's overrepresented? You know, you could go on and on about exactly what it is that your values are and what goals you want to put in. And that suggests that it's not necessarily the data or the algorithms, it's the values mm-hmm. that ultimately are the ones that we have to start working on. And sadly, I have the sense, and this is a question for all of you, is that we've made much less progress in specifying our values, thinking them through. I know the philosophers have been working on it for a few thousand years. It's not clear they've made as much progress over time. Maybe, you know, I talked to someone, they say, yes, we have. We actually have worked this through a bit. But as we get to have more degrees of freedom and more power to decide exactly how, you know, who gets the job or who gets put in jail, whatever, and we have more technological tools that allow us to make those decisions in a more subtle and fine-grained way, that means that our values become that much more important, and that seems to be a place where we need to put a lot more thought into.
So let's just open that up. Sandy, you have your hand up. Yes. And if you have a question, raise your hand so that they can come with the microphones.
So if you look at, for instance, the UN report we put together, this is a central issue. You have to remember, Rome wasn't built in a day. We're not going to move to a positive data world in a day. A first step is producing some metrics of what's going on. We live in a world that is incredibly opaque. Until very recently, you could have millions of people starving to death, and the capital city wouldn't even know about it until they were all dead. You could have these huge plagues. People wouldn't even know about it until it had been way out of hand. That world is going away. We're getting a world now where we have data about things pretty much in real time. Now, what data do we want? What features do we want? What values do we want? Is the debate that, optimistically, we can now have that debate for the first time. Because it's not just abstract discussion. You can actually see things happening now. And no, we don't know how to do that, and we don't have consistent values. A lot of the opaque world that we live in is okay because I don't know that you disagree with me, right? We don't have any objective facts. You see it differently than I do. And there are no real facts, you know? Well, that's going away. There's going to be data. You can argue about the algorithm. You can argue about the validity of the data. But what's happening there is we're actually arguing about values, which is the point of real engagement.
Alessandro, you had a...
I thought Eric brought up such an important issue, the values of a society, connecting your remark to what Sandis was mentioning earlier, the analogy of code and law. Typically, the values of a society are embedded in the laws which are enacted in a country. To some extent, through a democratic process, we pass laws which embed the values we believe in. What is fascinating to me, and I'm connecting to Safia mentioned earlier about the hiring experiment we ran, is that the technologies we are developing now can actually, may have the power of bypassing the laws, and therefore bypassing these values, such as we decided that certain information should not be used in the hiring process, and now you may end up being used, not intentionally so, not maliciously so, but nevertheless it may end up being used because somehow the algorithm capture indirectly, perhaps, the same information ends up using it. We decided that certain information should not be used to discriminate in credit, to assign higher or lower premium. And again, an algorithm may end up doing that, not maliciously, not willingly, but it may be some outcome, some unintended outcome. And this is, to me, really the crucial, terrifying, but also intellectually very interesting tension.
Algorithm may not embody the society's values. I guess I would quibble with the premise that the laws necessarily do too. I mean, they're made by a very specific subset of the people in the society, not even in a democracy.
So, David, and then there's a question here.
Yeah, I want to echo something that I think was alluded to in the comments that we heard from Sandy, which is that I think about bias as when we associate a characteristic with an individual that is assumed to be associated with some attribute we see of that individual and we assume is associated with the group that shares that attribute. I think the good news here is that if we can get data down to the individual level, then we don't need the proxies that we might be otherwise more likely or more tempted to use as a way to make decisions. So that's, I think, a very positive piece of information. It means if I can truly understand the individual, then I no longer need to assume some proxy that has been some shorthand for how we've developed rules that may incorrectly make assumptions about an individual. The thing I think is very interesting about that is it gets, I think, to a tension between privacy and fairness, because it suggests that if I can really get to the heart of who you are, then we need to be less concerned about biases. And I also think there's a very good thing here, which is that we're having this conversation, that algorithms are going to have to codify things that we've tried to think about as society, is a very good thing, because it's going to make us be much more rigorous about what we mean when we say bias. And I think we probably all disagree about what we mean when we say bias, because I see Eric is disagreeing with me.
If you're an individual, down to an individual level, I assume you're still thinking of making a probabilistic estimate of what that individual will do. You don't have perfect, exact prediction, and that probability is conditioned on some characteristics, right? So their height or whatever is. So I'm not sure that
the point is that as I get closer and closer to things that will be predictive about the way that individual.
Are you just saying
behave,
if you had perfect prediction, it wouldn't be an issue?
No. I mean, Eric, think about it. Like, if I walk in and say, all right, meet Susan, you know, she's going to talk to your tech firm, mm-hmm. And I say nothing else, what are you going to, I'm a marketing person, maybe I'm a salesperson, probably don't know much about tech, I probably never coded, I wasn't certainly coding when I was 10, you know, all these things, right? But if you walked in instead and you had like all of my test scores and all of my everything I've ever done, all my projects, you know, then you would condition on that and not like, here's this friendly looking woman, maybe
you're,
she's
you're
a mom.
You're conditioned on one set of things versus others, and you're saying that some things, sorts of things are not biased and other things are
no,
biased?
No, well, so I guess, I think David was just saying that in general, being a female is predictive of a bunch of stuff if you don't
and
know
so
anything else about me. But if you knew a bunch of other things about me, the model would no longer load on female.
No, but it might load on test scores.
And so I guess
you get more information, the general tendency is to smaller errors.
Yeah, you're going
to
get less.
And we will design the measures to reduce error, right?
Yeah.
And a big debate that people might want to get involved in is, how do you get data about individual people without compromising individual privacy?
That's a different question.
But it's related to, can you actually build a world where you can get this data and do things? Because if you can't have valid assertions about people without violating privacy, then you're going to have a hard time getting to the good part of this. You're going to be stuck at the bad part.
But so, I mean, test scores could still reflect, you know, in the tests are biased. You know, there's in some sense, there's always going to be biases in things.
Yeah,
and it could be that even conditional on all of my test scores, if you also condition that I just had a baby 2 months ago, that would be predictive of the, my hours per week. And so then you could decide whether or not you wanted to use that.
Exactly.
Or not. And then we have to have a discussion about exactly what's predictive. If you think about the judicial bail thing, I also have given some thought to that. You know, do I want to, suppose I don't want to put in race, but then I put in what kind of store did you rob? You know, it probably, you know, the kind of store you robbed is probably correlated with your race. On the other hand, it may also be correlated, like if you robbed the liquor store, that might
question.
Be different than
you're,
robbing
I think
something
you're, all, you're assuming something a little different than I'm assuming. You're assuming that race is bad to condition on, but that test scores or grit, how hardworking you are, is good to condition on. Those are particular values. And in our particular culture, that seems like a fair thing. What I'm saying, there's an implicit value judgment. Just if you want to step back a little bit, any prediction you make is going to be based on some set of variables, and we have to decide which ones we think are the ones that are, quote,
right.
badly
but
biased
Eric,
versus others
that's
are legitimately
a discussion.
Biased. Yeah.
We have a bunch of prejudices about
exactly.
which things are good and which things are bad.
Exactly.
And we're going to take a crack at it, okay? And we're going to screw up. And we ought to be having a system that evaluates how we evaluate.
Yes.
Are we getting the thing? So for instance, this, just to go back to the UN, the UN has decided every 15 years it's going to have a bottom-up redesign of what it means to have a good society. And it's going to change the way it measures that. And it's going to try and push people to do it. And I can guarantee you it's not going to work that well. But I can also almost guarantee you that it's going to be better than the way it's been.
So I'm gonna transition over here to another question just to move
Thank
a little
you.
Bit.
So I have a quick question about the bias in the algorithm design. So most of the time when you do the algorithm study, you have to do mathematical modeling of the real world problems. And in that process, you may have to say make some assumptions, to make your problem be easier, otherwise you face NP hard problem all the time. So my question is, in order to eliminate, the bias in the algorithm, do you think we should make laws say, okay, is there any certain assumption you cannot make? Or we should make it less strict, saying that this should be like an industry ethic, there's certain assumption you should not make. Thank you.
Anybody want to?
Well, I don't think that these things will be easy to legislate. I mean, even look at the way the current laws are written, there are all these complications with other covariates that are correlated with race. And it seems pretty clear to me that the legal framework is very brittle, is inadequate for algorithmic systems. I do think it's crucial that ethics are a topic that are taught in engineering schools and that are a topic that are held up as of importance within our technology firms. I don't know where this is all going to go. I'm generally optimistic that I think these types of discussions we're having mean that we'll come to embrace just how important this is, because we are about to have algorithmic systems everywhere.
So do you think that a better focus is on the inputs or the outcomes? In other words, should we be focusing on making sure we don't use certain factors in the predictive model, or that we don't have discrimination in lending practice outcomes?
Well, I think that even I would vote for outcomes, but I don't like that either, because it's a dynamic system. You talked about systematic problems. What you want to have is you want to have something where the dynamics of the system, the society, tend towards something that we believe are common good values. So that means you're going to, for instance, build in certain biases to cause the system to move away from its current state towards a state that you believe is better. And if you're smart, you're going to check how it's doing all the way along. So we have these sequential estimators that are going to say, well, you know, we want fewer murders. Well, that seems like a pretty good one, so let's keep track of that. Let's keep a track of intergenerational mobility. That seems like a pretty good one, too. But, you know, that may actually have problems at some point, right? Like GDP was really good when they put it in. It was sort of nice to know what money was, right? But now, all these years later, we use it a little too much, don't we?
So, I mean, I think it's basically just completely ineffective to do inputs in the current world. So it's not just not useful. Outputs may be useful, maybe not be useful, but I think we can at least reason about making outputs useful. One thing, even like in, again, tech firms, when people if you talk to an engineer on a complicated team, you can ask them how the algorithm works, and they're going to be able to give you sort of an engineering description. But then if you say, well, do you think that really what the algorithm is doing is picking up this other thing, you know? And I used to ask a lot of these questions around search advertising algorithms. You know, people really, they really have no idea most of the time. If I ask a question like that, then you do a little analytics project to see how the algorithm is working. Now you build into the A/B testing platform something that shows you the heterogeneous treatment effects. And then that's going to illuminate.
I slipped that in, by the way.
I had to slip in heterogeneous treatment effects. I couldn't stop. But it's exactly that. The engineers themselves don't understand why their algorithm worked until you show them through data analysis. And you know, they might have an idea, but they're often surprised. And so then if we say, all right, we look at this algorithm, it seems to be, we could systematically, for certain types of algorithms, say, does it seem to be having a differential impact along these sort of protected or societal interest dimensions? Then you can go back and think, is that good? Is it bad? Is it an accident? Is there some other confounder that's causing that, and that it's all good, it's all fine? Or is it actually, you know, some variable is a good proxy for women and not for men, or a good proxy for some races and not another race, and then it's actually a good diagnostic to help you improve improve the problem.
So I had a question about some of the things that we might be losing with algorithms and like recommendation engines specifically. Parents often will have their kids try new things, not because they think they're going to like them, but because they think there's something valuable and expanding their horizons, right? Adults will wander a store and see new things, not just the sections or stores they've been to before. But if you look at things like the project that the Wall Street Journal put together about Facebook feeds of people with two different ideologies, and they only see new stories that confirm their own biases.
Actually, Eitan sort of proved that wasn't true on Facebook. Is that right, Eitan? Go ahead, sorry.
Well, in general, like there's any sort of way where like you like this certain thing, so you like this next thing, and you kind of leave out everything else. Has anybody on the panel seen or thought about anything about how to kind of preserve that idea of seeing the other stuff that would be healthy for a person to be exposed to?
So we've done a study in a large European city where we have online activity, we have purchase behavior, we have physical mobility, we know where people go, we know voting behavior, we know health behaviors, all for the same people. And what's interesting is that you see that online behavior largely mirrors physical behavior. So the segregation you see in society, physical segregation, and it's mostly between poor, middle class, rich, is mirrored in the online activity, at least that we see. And the purchase behavior, of course, follows that too. And the politics follow that. And so that suggests that, and the structures of the networks are similar too. What it suggests to me, and you know, I don't have like absolute proof about this, is that a lot of the physical experience is driving the conversation, okay, and conversation between people. There's some evidence that a way to get out of these echo chambers is by having more physical mixing. So online mixing doesn't seem to be as effective because people immediately resegregate, right? But if you work in the same areas and see the different people, and there was a wonderful NBER study actually that showed that if you looked at intergenerational mobility, the biggest predictor of mobility were essentially spatial mixing between different income levels. So if you were a poor kid and you saw middle class people, you know, when you were young, and this is very young, like under five, then your chances at intergenerational mobility were much higher. And you know, we don't know why, but you can speculate that you learn something about how rules and diversity and things like that play out in society when you're that young, really basic stuff. Mm-hmm. And so we don't know, but this is an example of a really important question, I think.
Actually, I think the science is part of this. Actually, the tech firms, in some cases, they have the right interest, but actually, the algorithms aren't good enough. You know, the basic recommendation algorithms don't do enough exploration. Like, the you know, for many years, the incarnations of the search engines didn't do enough exploration. Like, and that was partly just because the first thing you build is like, let's just give everybody the best thing, and it's actually harder to build optimal exploration into your systems. There were papers on that today. There'd be more tomorrow. A bunch of people here are at the forefront of that. So actually, I think we may get better just as we do better AI. Mm-hmm. But then there's also a trade-off as well that, you know, the interest of a particular website might want to not internalize the full benefit of having you be exposed to a wide range of things, and they're going to focus too much on having you come back. Right now, they focus too much on the very, very short term. And they actually don't even optimize their own objective well. But even once they get better at it, if all the people in the room here are successful, in 5 years, the websites will be better optimizing their own objectives. But they still don't have the full societal objective of having you get exposed to a wider range of things.
So there's a question right here.
Thank you very much. Thank you, all panelists, for having this incredibly insightful discussion. This has been super enriching, I think, for all of us. One of the points that you guys brought up earlier was the role of values in determining kind of the functioning of algorithms, what we set our algorithms to do. What would be the value of the human being in a world that is kind of so enhanced by algorithms? And how can we make sure that the next several decades, which are going to see a lot of social displacement as a result of algorithmically based HR directors making choices that are less biased and algorithmically based drivers taking our vehicles around the streets that would displace millions and millions of people, don't kind of end up being the undoing of this more equal vision for the future, or better vision for the future?
Is it a question about robots replacing humans, or
yes, exactly,
robot Uber drivers taking us where I didn't tell the car to go?
About robots replacing humans.
Okay. Anybody want to take on Terminator?
I'll speculate. So one of the things is we have a sort of large initiative in the Media Lab around human augmentation as opposed to human replacement. The idea of a robot is only one vision of AI. It's a vision in which the human is replaced or made, there's an equivalent to a human created. You can have another vision, which is something that makes humans work together better. That's another style of AI, but that's not nearly as scary. We don't know what's going to win. It'll obviously be sort of a mix of things. It probably won't be just the Terminator. Two things that I find really interesting. I'll just, this is something we did just the other day is We looked at online financial trading behavior of some millions of people. And we looked at what are considered optimal policies. And then we looked at optimal policies that instead of using objective data, you know, like performance and so forth, looked at people's subjective judgments and then aggregated those. Beat the objective ones, same techniques, right? So there was more information that the humans were gathering for the final sort of AI step than you got from what the humans were supposed to be looking at. So where'd that other information come from? Well, talking to the people at work, seeing whether your boss is cranky, who's buying what on the street, a bunch of things that argue that there is a room for this sort of enhanced society as opposed to a replaced society. This is all soft. I mean, I'm not going to defend it, right? But
just to build on that a little bit and maybe make a plug for the following report, Eric and myself and Julie Shar, I don't know if she's in the room, and others were just involved in an inaugural report of what will be a 100-year study into AI. Now, I don't plan to be involved in that for 100 years, unless there are more dramatic improvements in human health than we're currently anticipating. But we just wrote...
Singularity is near.
Yes, indeed. We just wrote a study about what we think will be happening with AI in the North American urban context in 2030. So if you go to the AI 100 page, you can read about this. And the point I wanted to make is that there's a lot of good that's going to come from what we're about to see in health, in transportation, in home robotics, in policing, in justice. We've got to get this all right, but there are good things that can come. And on the other hand, this will have a distributional effect. And one of the things that we're trying to be encouraged about within the AI community is I don't think that scientists should abdicate this discussion about the wealth that will be created and the need for thinking about the distributional effect that that will have. I think we need to be a part of that conversation because it's an extremely important conversation. And I wanted to close this comment by saying that the thing that I actually am mainly, that I'm mainly worried about myself is the idea that the very best AI might become owned by one company. I think that's, I mean, the question is how far ahead will they be and how far ahead do they need to be? But I do worry that there's an arms race right now where three big firms, maybe more, maybe less, depending on who you talk to, are investing a huge amount of money acquiring most of the talent that used to be in academia. And there will be network effects here. Yeah. And there will quite possibly emerge a winner there. And that, I think, is a concern.
Can I just pick up on that? That's actually one of my biggest issues, I think, is underappreciated when this popular discussion about this distributional things. So there's kind of two, I think, kind of counterfactual future worlds we can imagine. Like, one is that sort of all this AI and stuff is very distributed. It's kind of like you can enter a ride-sharing platform today by building on top of Google Maps and all sorts in the phones and GPS and all of these things, and you can enter very easily, have a ride-sharing company today. And so that's competitive, and so, like, you know, we all get cheap rides, and so the cost of transportation just fell enormously. That actually is a reduction in the cost of living, which is an improvement in our welfare, an increase in our real wages, basically. On the other hand, you know, if you have sort of more like, you know, concentration, like we've seen in search engines or some of these other very machine learning, data-intensive things, then, you know, if things are concentrated, there's no guarantee that sort of the prices will fall at the same rate that the productivity increases. And so if the prices don't fall, then we're going to have to do massive redistribution. And, you know, that requires a very functional political system. We actually don't know how to redistribute very well. We don't know how to transition people from one career to another very well right now. Like, we just don't have those public policies well executed. And if it turns out that our democracy and our kind of safety depends on being able to redistribute, I don't think we could actually 5 years from now, you know, go out and say, oh, we know how to redistribute and retrain people and make them happier if all the profits are concentrated. So, you know, I hope that we do the things collectively as a society to both keep things competitive enough that all the benefits do get redistributed. Yeah, wages fall, but also prices fall. And transportation costs fall and healthcare costs fall. That'd be awesome. Or if we do end up in a situation with a lot of concentration, we're going to need to start quickly doing that same kind of incremental innovation and A/B testing and things about societal programs that actually, you know, effectively redistribute to displaced people.
Alessandro?
Completely agree, and I would add that the which outcome of these two parallel worlds we will live in will depend not only on who controls the best algorithm, but also who controls data, and specifically personal data, which is why, and he didn't pay me at all for this plug, initiatives such as the Open Algorithms Initiative by Sandy are so crucial in my view.
Sandy.
So one thing about this discussion is that it has a very Western view. You know, China is putting enormous amounts of money into this and has extraordinary technical talent. It would be really surprising if Russia wasn't doing this. And I have to tell you, you know, mathematics in Russia is just awesome. it's incredible. And so those are non-economic actors in the sense that, in the classic sense, they're sort of long play, cultural conflict type of situations. Add to that that the Department of Defense has declared that the third offset, which I don't know if I want to explain that, but basically the strategic advantage that they will pursue has to do with distributed AI. So the first offset was nuclear weapons. Mm-hmm. So you might want to think about what it means that the Department of Defense has as its policy that distributed AI is a major core advantage. And of course, mm-hmm. everybody knows this. Mm-hmm. China, mm-hmm. Russia, you name it. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't put Iran out of the running. I mean, it's sort of funny if you look around here, a lot of the best economics, math, and stuff are all Iranians who escaped. I mean, somehow they know how to do this, right? So, yeah.
Catherine, is that a...
Oh, yeah, no, I was just going to add to this that I think this makes it incredibly, you know, given this vision of the future, which Susan's laid out for us, I think there's a lot of work for us in this room to think about, well, what really would lead to that concentration of power. Is this about labor markets, in which case we should be thinking about how to ensure we've got free flow of tech talent, which is not clear that happens right now? Are we worried about, say, intellectual property protection on algorithms? Should we be thinking preemptively about patenting policy towards this? I think if we're sort of thinking this is one thing we're worrying about in the future, it seems a clear place for economists to sort of think, well, what are we really worried about? What are going to be those sources of network effects or economies of scope which could lead to concentration?
Great point. So we're going to close with a question from Jess.
This is great. This is an awesome panel. Thanks. So I'm a statistician and political scientist, and that causes me like lots of consternation, particularly on this issue. So with my statistician hat, we'll take the recidivism example. Right, what's often lost in that debate, if you look at the data, a grad student has that data, has recidivism data from other cities, African Americans had a higher recidivism rate than whites in the low risk category, the medium risk category, and the high risk category. That's just a thing in the data. The algorithm found that out. Once the algorithm finds that out, it is just a fact of basic algebra that the false discovery rate will be higher for blacks than whites. The only way to equalize the false discovery rate is to increase the mean squared error of the algorithm, right? So if we rely on like testing what the algorithms do, well, then what metric do we use? As a society, do we value the false discovery rate or do we value lower mean squared error? Mm-hmm. So And then getting back to Eric's thing, as a political scientist, I look at the decisions we make and I go, I see rent seeking, I see regulatory capture, and I see mass inefficiency, and I go, hey, you can see, you know, we see innovation everywhere but in the productivity numbers. Mm-hmm. So I don't want that same system controlling these new innovations. It's not necessarily a good thing. So on the one hand, so both of the things that people said, maybe there's hope of controlling these algorithms. One is looking at outcomes. If you look at that, do you care about false discovery or mean squared error? By mean squared error, that algorithm is not discriminating, mm-hmm. right? By false discovery rate, it is. What do we value? Well, we'll turn the political system. That doesn't seem that it's going to necessarily make the wisest or most efficient or even most just choices.
So let me color that by saying, you know, this is also related to this idea of, you know, whether algorithms are just a mirror onto the society that we live in, and whose fault is that? Is it the fault of the algorithm or the society we gave it to study? And I also think that you should ask the question about mean squared error or false discovery rate in a presidential debate and see what happens. So who wants to take that one?
Well, just really short. So the point, I think, is that by having discovered those, you can have a debate about it. Currently, or until recently, this was just a hidden fact. Nobody knew it. It just happened. And so now, at least, it's more visible, and we can decide, you know, what do we value more? Do we want to be proactive about some things? You know, invest some higher recidivism in order to achieve other ends, or what, right? But without the data, you can't have the debate.
Okay, well, this brings us to a close of the panel. Let's give a warm round of applause to our panelists. We really appreciate it.